Hey, how you guys doing? This is Shock. And sometimes when I'm talking to unbelievers, they will say incorrectly so. They'll say, "Oh, the Bible's just like Harry Potter." And I could understand if the person was a little kid saying that, but these are like adults that will say things like that. And this just shows they're kind of ignorant of the type of documents that the Bible come from. For example, we're going to be reading from Galatians, and Galatians reads almost like a autobiography. And you're going to hear how Paul actually was killing Christians, and he has a radical conversion because he witnesses the appearance of Jesus Christ. So Paul is like, imagine the most hostile person to Christianity, and he gets radically converted. And so it's pretty hard to explain away these type of things. And when you actually read it, it even has a flavor to it, like a biography or an autobiography, where they're actually talking about it, sort of like someone's diary or their journal. So it's not a fictional book. These events actually happened. And we're going to be reading through Galatians right now. Now, the foundational study of Galatians shows us how the work of Jesus' death on the cross provides us with everything we need for salvation. That's really what you're going to hear about here on Galatians. Now, many early Jewish Christians had grown confused about the role of Gentiles in Christianity. And so there was a radical sect called the Judaizers that taught no Gentile could be saved without also adhering to the Jewish law. So what you're going to find here is Paul counters that by continuing to follow the law, that these Judaizers were in fact negating the grace of God. If the law were the most important thing in salvation, Paul insists, then Christ died for nothing and the new covenant is nullified. Rather, the law exists to show us our sin and to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor, which is the law. He says this in 3:24 and 25. Paul says that we did not receive the Holy Spirit because we followed the law, but because we believed in Christ, we received the Holy Spirit. So why should we think that we would continue to be saved through keeping the law, Paul says. Christ's death freed us from the constraints of the law, something we should celebrate. We are no longer bound to a code that prescribes death, but rather we can live to the fullness in Christ. And Paul reminds us, however, not to waste our freedom on a sinful life, but to use it to glorify the Lord and live according to his holy will. If we live in such a way, we will begin to show the fruit of the Spirit. He mentions this in 5:22, 5:23. The grace of God is sufficient for our salvation and bestows upon us the life God meant us to live. Nothing needs to be added to the work of Jesus, nor does it need to be improved. You simply can't improve upon perfection. And remember the last words that Jesus said on the cross, tetelestai, which is to say, it is finished. So let's get into this. You guys are going to like this. It starts off with a greeting. Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren who are with me. So he's writing this to the churches of Galatia. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, notice, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil age according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, what's interesting here is already people are creeping into the church already trying to pervert the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul's marveling at this. He says, I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. And then look what he says, which is not another. In other words, there's no such thing as two gospels. There's one gospel. But he's saying that you're changing it. He says, but there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I still please men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ. But I make known to you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man, for I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but notice, but it came through the revelation of Jesus Christ. And then remember, Paul was there when the first martyr for Jesus Christ was murdered. He gave his approval of the murder of Stephen. Paul was there. And as they were stoning Stephen, they cast their clothes down at Paul's feet here. So Paul's talking about where he came from here. Look, he goes, for you have heard of my former conduct in Judaism. I mean, this dude, Paul, he was literally a murderer. He was killing Christians. How I persecuted the church of God beyond measure, and look, and tried to destroy it. And I advanced in Judaism beyond many of my contemporaries in my own nation. So he was good at what he did, and he was very zealous, very, very educated. He had a brilliant mind, being more exceedingly zealous for the traditions of my fathers, notice. Well, then what happened? He says it plainly. Paul says, but when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately confer with flesh and blood, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me, but I went to Arabia and returned again to Damascus. Then after 3 years, watch this, guys, look who he goes to see. I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter. This is the same Peter that walked with Jesus Christ and remained with him 15 days. Peter, who swore that he saw Jesus Christ crucified and risen again. Let's go to this over here. This is the same Peter that Paul meets with where this event happens right here. It says, now Jesus and his disciples went out to the towns of Caesarea Philippi, and on the road he asked his disciples, saying to them, who do men say that I am? So they answered, John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say you're one of the prophets. Then Jesus asked them, but who do you say that I am? And the same Peter that Paul is talking about over here, okay, this is what Peter says. You are the Christ. Then he strictly warned them that they should tell no one about him, and he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed, and notice, after 3 days, rise again. So when Paul is talking about Peter here, he's talking about this Peter that witnessed Jesus Christ rise again and walk with Jesus Christ. And notice he says, but I saw none of the other apostles except James, notice, Jesus' brother. So this Paul here even gets to know Jesus' brother. He says, now concerning the things which I write to you, indeed before God, I do not lie. afterward I went to the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and I was unknown by face to the churches of Judea which were in Christ, but they were hearing only. So they're hearing about Paul, but they don't really know who he is yet. They would refer to Paul, he who formerly persecuted us now preaches the faith which he once tried to destroy. And look at this, and they glorified God in me. So Paul, his life is glorifying to God. Here, they all knew Paul, that he was a bad guy, killing Christians, trying to stop Christianity, and now he becomes a key figure in the promotion of Christianity. Let's go to the next page. Then Paul's saying, and notice this isn't a fictional writing like a Harry Potter type thing that sometimes people will say. This is his actual biography here, as a journal, what happened. He says, then after 14 years I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, and also took Titus with me, and I went up by revelation and communicated to them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to those who were of reputation, lest by any means I might run, or had run, in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. So watch this, is they, before the law said that they had to be circumcised, but now that they have this freedom and grace within Jesus Christ, Titus is not compelled to be circumcised. Now, look at this. It says, and this occurred because of, look at this, false brethren secretly brought in. What's happening here? Okay, these people were so zealous for the law that they're trying to spy on Titus and Paul to see if they're circumcised. That's exactly what it's saying. It says, who came in by stealth to spy out our liberty which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. So they're so zealous for the law, they're trying to see if they're circumcised. To whom we did not yield submission even for an hour, that the truth of gospel might continue with you. So they stood up boldly for Jesus Christ. But from those who seem to be something, whatever they were, it makes no difference to me. God shows personal favoritism to no man. For those who seemed to be something added nothing to me. But on the contrary, when they saw that the gospel for the uncircumcised had been committed to me, as the gospel for the circumcised was to Peter, for he who worked effectively in Peter for the apostleship to the circumcised also worked effectively in me toward the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, this is a real beautiful thing right here. Watch this. So he meets James, Cephas, and John, and they seem to be pillars in the gospel. They're strong in the gospel. They perceived the grace that had been given to me, to Paul. They gave me and Barnabas, look, the right hand of fellowship, so they become friends, that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. They desired only that we should remember the poor, the very thing which I also was eager to do. Now when Peter had come to Antioch, and watch this here, Peter and Paul have a little friendly disagreement here, and Paul's right here. See, Peter's trying not to cause problems between people that feel that they need to be under the law and circumcised, but what he does is he does it the wrong way. He kind of distances himself from the people that were not circumcised because he didn't want to offend the people that were. Watch this. And Paul brings this to his attention and makes a point out of this. He says, now when Peter had come to Antioch, I withstood him to his face because he was to be blamed. So Peter messes up here. It says, for before certain men came from James, he would eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing those who were of the circumcision. So Peter's eating with these men that are most likely Gentiles, and they've come in with James. They're not circumcised. But when the people that were under the law, that would focus on the law, came in, notice what happened. Peter didn't want to be seen with the Gentiles anymore. So he feared those who were of the circumcision. And the rest of the Jews also played the hypocrite with him. So even Barnabas was carried away with their hypocrisy. So they start, imagine this, the people that come in that are circumcised come in, and all of a sudden Peter leaves your side and Barnabas leaves your side, and they go hang out with the ones that are under the law, the ones that are circumcised. That's not right. And Paul, he says, but when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, look, if you being a Jew live in the manner of Gentiles and not as the Jews, why do you compel Gentiles to live as Jews? So in other words, Peter would go hang out with people that weren't circumcised. They weren't under the law. They were under the grace in Jesus Christ. But then he would want to compel these Gentiles to be like Jews and be circumcised. And notice Paul says, we who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man, notice guys, is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Christ Jesus that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For look, by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. But if while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners, is Christ therefore a minister of sin? What does this mean right here? It doesn't mean that because we're no longer under the bondage of the law, that then we should gravitate towards lawlessness and try to sin. This is what he's saying. He goes, certainly not. For if I build again those things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. For I through the law died to the law that I might live to God. So when you do these good things and you're doing them what? Out of love for God. Everything's love for God. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God. For if righteousness comes through the law, here it is, guys, then Christ died in vain. So you can do good things. You can give to the poor. You can do good works. You can do these things, and you do them because you love Christ. But you don't do them because they justify you and your works are justified. You do them because it's just a natural outflowing of your fruits, because now you're under the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ. And so Paul continues, he goes, oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth before whose eyes Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed among you as crucified? This only I want to learn from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Good question, because obviously it's by the hearing of faith, right? Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now being made perfect by the flesh? In other words, your works aren't going to save you, he's saying. Have you suffered so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Therefore, Paul says, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Just as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Therefore, know that only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, in you all the nations shall be blessed. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. Now, sometimes I'll talk to people that are atheists. I'll talk to people that are in Islam. We'll talk to these people that will say, well, we believe that it's good to help the poor, and we believe it's good to do this and it's good to do that, right? And but what happens is they're still under the law. It doesn't matter if you're an atheist and you do all types of good things. It will help other people, but it doesn't mean that you escape the law. You're still under the law. It doesn't matter if you're a Muslim and you do good things, you do your rituals, you help the poor, and so you're still under the law. And Scripture says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, me included. But through grace through Jesus Christ, because he took our punishment on the cross and is a propitiation for our sin, the wrath of God has been poured out on Jesus Christ already. So through grace in Jesus Christ, we are saved. But if you think you're going to do good works and you're going to be justified by the law, it is the law that condemns you. The law is really just a mirror that you look upon and you realize that you cannot fulfill the law. It's a schoolmaster that guides us towards the cross. Notice what Paul says. For as many as are the works of the law are under the curse. You see that? For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all the things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them. So, if I'm going to go and try to fulfill the law, I've already broken the law. And look at the commandments also. If you've broken one of the commandments, you've broken them all. It's too late for all of us. The law brings a curse, Paul says. And then he says, brethren, I speak in the manner of men, though it is only a man's covenant, yet if he is confirmed, no one annuls or adds to it. Now, to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds, as of many, but as of one. And to your seed, who is Christ. And this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by God in Christ, that it should make the promise of no effect. For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise. So what was the purpose of the law? Well, we just talked about this. Why? Then what purpose then does the law serve? It was added because of transgressions till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. And it was appointed through angels by the hand of a mediator. Now a mediator does not mediate for one only, but God is one. Is the law then against the promises of God? Certainly not. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, notice guys, truly righteousness would have been by the law. But the Scripture has confined all under sin. There it is. That's you and I, everyone, that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. But before faith came, we were kept under guard by the law, kept for the faith which would afterward be revealed. Therefore, and this is what I was mentioning before, our law was our tutor, our schoolmaster. Therefore, the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ. Notice, because we realize that we fall short of the law and we need to turn to Christ. So the law does have a good purpose. Therefore, the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ, that we might be what? Justified by faith. But after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. So this is awesome what Jesus Christ has given us. Paul says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. Think about that. If you're watching this right now, you know, you're considered, you are a son of God through faith in Christ Jesus. And notice, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male or female, for, this is beautiful, look, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. That was very well said. Now, let's talk about some of the fears that Paul has. He says, "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is master of all, but is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the Father. Even so, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law." Notice, guys, this is why Jesus Christ came into the world. He's born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, "Abba, Father." Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. If you guys click below this video, I'm going to put a link to a debate I had with an atheist. And I was talking to him in the debate. I said, atheists literally are slaves. They are still slaves to their sin. Jesus Christ said, we have sinned, we are slaves to our sin, but if the Son of Man sets you free, you are free indeed. It is the atheist that are literally in slavery, and how they forge the ball and chain stronger and stronger day after day. But notice, people like me, that I'm an ex-atheist, and people like you that have become Christians, notice he says, therefore you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. And here's some of Paul's fears for the church. He says, but then indeed, when you did not know God, you served those which by nature are not gods. But now after you have known God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements to which you desire again to be in bondage? Sometimes I'll talk to people and they'll say that when they were a kid, they were a Christian, or they used to be a Christian and stuff. And if Paul was able to talk to him, he would say to them, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements to which you desire again to be in bondage? In other words, why would you want to be a slave? He says, you observe days and months and seasons and years. I'm afraid for you, lest I have labored for you in vain. He can't get through to them, you see, some of them. So he says, brethren, I urge you to become like me, for I became like you. You have not injured me at all. You know that because of physical infirmity, I preached the gospel to you at first. And my trial, which was in my flesh, you did not despise or reject, but you received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Now, a lot of biblical scholars say that there was something wrong, possibly, with Paul physically. And I don't know what it is, but throughout Scripture you'll get these little hints like this. Notice he says, you know that because of physical infirmity I preached the gospel to you at first, and my trial, which was in my flesh, you did not despise or reject. But notice, they were very kind to Paul. But you received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. What then was the blessing you enjoyed? For I bear you witness that, if possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. Have I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? This is a very beautiful moment here where Paul's trying to show them that we're under the grace of God. Notice up here he says, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements to which you desire again to be in bondage? And he talks about when he first came to them, how they loved him so much. Notice he says that you receive me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. But notice now they're going back into the world. He says here, Paul says, he's talking about how they loved him. They said, if it were possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. That's how much they were showing they loved Paul. And now that Paul's telling him the truth here, he says, have I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? And isn't that, if you're a Christian, isn't that so apropos for today's times in 2012 and beyond, is when you tell people the truth, sometimes they treat you like you're their enemy, when the only reason why you're telling them is because you love them and you care about them. You want to see them saved. And Paul's the same way. He goes, they zealously court you, but for no good. Yes, they want to exclude you that you may be zealous for them. He's talking about how people are trying to draw them away from Christ. He goes, but it is good to be zealous in a good thing always, and not only when I am present with you. My little children, for whom I labor in birth again until Christ is formed in you, I would like to be present with you now and to change my tone, for I have doubts about you. Interesting. He says, tell me, you who desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? Like, he's like, don't you understand what the law is going to do? He says, for it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondwoman, the other by a free woman. But he who is of the bondwoman, notice, was born according to the flesh, and he of the free woman through promise. Which things are symbolic? For these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gives birth to bondage, which is Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to Jerusalem, which now is and is in bondage with their children. But the Jerusalem above is free, which is the mother of us all, for it is written, rejoice, O barren, you who do not bear, break forth and shout, you who are not in labor, for the desolate has many more children than she who has a husband. So what Paul's showing here is he's talking about the story of Abraham, and he's talking about the two sons, one that was born through bondage and one that was born free. He says, now we brethren, as Isaac was, are children of promise, the free one. But as he who was born according to the flesh then persecuted him who was born according to the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what does the scripture say? Cast out the bondwoman and her son. For the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not the children of the bondwoman, but of the free. All right, let's end on this page. Let's end on this page, guys. We have liberty in Christianity. The person that is most free in this world is the Christian. There is nobody, atheist, agnostic, Muslim, Buddhist, Hindu, pagan, Wiccan, there is nobody that is as free as the Christian. Look what Paul says. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free. And do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the whole law. You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by law, look at this, guys, you have fallen from grace, Paul tells them. For we, through the Spirit, eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, notice. The only thing that avails is faith working through love. He says, you ran well. So these people were following Christ, but they fell. They went back into bondage. Paul says, you ran well. You were doing so good. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? What happened? What happened? He says, this persuasion does not come from him who calls you. Well, then where does it come from? Think about it, guys. Remember when Jesus said, look, if you're not with me, you're against me? He says here, Paul says, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in you, in the Lord, that you will have no other mind, but he who troubles you shall bear his judgment, whoever he is. Like, what is getting you to walk away from Christ, the freedom that you have in Christ? He says, you ran well. What the heck happened? And he says, and I, brethren, if I still preach circumcision, why do I still suffer persecution? Then the offense of the cross has ceased. I could wish that those who trouble you would even cut themselves off. For you, brethren, have been called, notice, to liberty. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word. Even in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. And let's end with this, guys, and thanks for watching and reading this Bible study. I love you, and I know you guys like these Bible studies. I like doing them too, so the feeling is mutual. Let's walk in the Spirit. Paul says, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Interesting. He basically says the Spirit and the flesh are at war with each other. Now the works of the flesh, this is interesting. Check this out, guys. He's going to talk about the works of the flesh, so these are the bad things, right? And then he's going to talk about the fruit of the Spirit. So first we're going to go through the bad, then we'll go through the good. He says, now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outburst of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just also as I told you in time past, and here it is, guys, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, let's go to the fruit of the Spirit. So up here you have the adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, hatred, murders, drunkenness, all this stuff, jealousy, sorcery, all this, right? These are the things that are like cancers in our life. But when we're in the flesh, this is the natural outcome of being in the flesh. What's the fruit of the Spirit? Here it is here. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, interesting, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. So God bless you guys. I love you. This is Shock. Let's remember, these are the works of the flesh. We want to stay away from those. And then these are the fruits of the Spirit. We want to gravitate towards those. To shockonnell.net. and you'll see the walkway here and the water, and then go here to where it says, I just added a bunch of stuff to the, here it is, free audio Bible. So you want to click this here and watch what happens. When you click it, you can stream the Bible just like what you heard right now, or you could download it for your MP3 player. This is not just Old Testament or New Testament. This is both the Old and the New Testament. And God bless you guys. Have a great week. Here you go right here, shotgunnow.net. Right here. Go there and you can get it. Bye for now.